Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, sorry for the delay and misunderstandings. I'm most happy to be invited to your City of Joy to talk about some of my views on related to cancer treatment. Of course, like the previous speaker, we understand that cancer therapy has not been perfect yet. That is why, for instance, in some of the surveys we did in Hong Kong, we found that 95% of our patients on cancer care have been using herbal medicine, either by themselves or through experts. Why? They want to improve their quality of life, they want to have supportive care. And all these, in the past 10 years, they've done some quite serious clinical studies concerning these. And then, of course, generally speaking, we can categorize the herbal users as those using them as supplementary herbs, as supplementary treatment, and for palliative care, for instance, control of nausea and so on. And then, of course, most of them after cancer treatment would think about dream of prevention. So these are the major areas of their concern. I think in Asia, in India, in Japan, in China, and even in the Middle East, a revival of looking at the real indications of for old herbal formulations has been going on. Herbal medicine or oriental medicine, no matter what we call it, is a real enthusiasm about the rediscovery of old herbal formulation. In Yale University, for instance, my old friend, oncologist in cancer treatment, has been using one of the most ancient simple formula to control nausea as a cancer supplementary. We use it for colorectal cancer. It's a simple formulation consisting of four herbs. And then we found accidentally to his joy, this simple formulation not only controls the nausea, but it also enhances the effect of cytotoxic drug, doxorubicin. So the research is still going on. Now, we want to be more innovative. Instead of following the ancient formulation for symptom control, we want to have something that would be really good to control cancer. Because we understand that what we want to have the control should be related to cell death, angiogenesis, metastasis, and also improving, boosting up the immunological defense. All these are needed for cancer control. So we have plenty of herbs historically and also in current study that are having those properties, those effects. We chose five of them, very general, very commonly used in Asian medicine. And yet they also found to be antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, producing apoptosis, boosting up immunological defense, and of course in specific animal models, we need to prove, we can prove that they are also anti-metastasis. So this is our paradigm of action. We believe that cancer control could be specific, could be target-oriented, and yet we still have 20-30% of failures. Under those circumstances, we can work on multiple target areas of trying to reduce apoptosis, trying to control angiogenesis, boosting up the immunological defense, and of course, if there are means, also prevent anti-metastasis. Those are the five herbs. We can put them into a legitimate biological study to prove that they do have such properties, and then after that we can put them into proper clinical trials. By the way, they are all traditionally used save herbs, not toxic herbs. So if you look at the treatment of cancer at large, of course we need all these, apoptosis, angiogenesis, anti-emetic, and also immunological support. These are the aims, and of course after a lot of work, we could go on to the area of bioavailability and further pharmacological studies, so that if the research direction for supplementary cancer treatment never interfere with the proper modern-day conventional cancer treatment, these are meant to be supplementary. We want to prove direct cytotoxicity. We want to prove immunological modulation in favor of cancer control. We want to prove anti-angiogenesis. And then lastly, we have animal model to prove anti-metastatic effects. Now, all these are standard platforms with in vitro, ex vivo, and in vivo support. All of us in bioscience study are aware of these and familiar with the procedures. These are relatively new, and in anti-angiogenic studies, you have, of course, in vitro cell culture models, and of course, in vivo study nowadays using the silverfish embryo has been very convenient. All these can be done very easily, and of course, at the end, we ought to prove the molecular pathways and so on. A summary of the various platform studies on these five herbs, we've been able to find that they are positive in all those aspects that we claim as anti-disease control. And then in the live animals, rats and mice impregnated with cancer loads, they do have a very positive response. Out of the five herbs we use, of course, the popular herbs used in Asia, in Japan and China in particular, would be those of fungal origin. Of course, we use from the German, Coriolis is something higher, growing in higher altitudes, and is very common in South China. And of course, Maitake in Japan is also very much in favor. We have relevant work in our laboratory in the past, aiming specifically to prove the immunomodulating effects of Coriolis, fungal origin mushroom. You can call it commonly in South China, particularly used for cancer patients of the female groups. Breast cancer in particular. And then of course, all these early studies that would encourage us very much to a bigger, more iterative study of using those five herbs as a common supplementary treatment for cancer patients. Of course, talking about anti-angiogenic effects, we have the famous Avastin, the first anti-angiogenic drug targeting for the anti-angiogenesis treatment of cancer of the colon. And of course, even Camellia, which is tea, our famous tea plant, can also be proven to have such effects. Now, going back to our five herbs, we've done our early study, and then putting them into the overall consideration of cancer treatment. We all endorse the importance of chemotherapy, the importance of radiotherapy, and of course recently specific target therapy. Why couldn't we, on top of all those standard treatments, try to help using the safe and harmless herbs that could be proven to have exactly similar desirable effects of immunomodulation, anti-angiogenesis, apoptosis promotion, and perhaps even empty metaphysics. This is our line of thought. Now, I want to talk about this because we have a new opportunity, the so-called metronomic chemotherapy initiation. This is an initiation related to cancer treatment, something like less than 10 years of age. In fact, before I joined this meeting, I made an inquiry from the organizing committee whether this topic would be discussed in this meeting. My answer was that possibly, but not so sure. I'm particularly looking forward to this because Indian oncologists are partly responsible to organize this initiative together with European, particularly French oncologists. It is something to go in line with the changing thoughts, changing the treatment policy from more than nearly 100 years, maybe 70 years of cancer research. We aim at maximal tolerable dosage, and then we have disappointing results. We want to have similar targets, and yet we still are looking for those particularly susceptible to these. So the metronomic chemo cancer therapy is a group that is specifically trying to help extremely late cases, the refractory patients, meaning those in spite of all the treatment they still have disappointing results. 20 to 30% of those would be something like a real data. And this initiation has been appointing various patients of what they call ambassadors. And I'm aware of that India has many ambassadors, like myself, who's been chosen one for Hong Kong and China. Now, this is very important because it's leading a way to a more systemic justification for the herbal use, I believe. Metronomic treatment for those refractory cases and for those that are too late, so all the treatment failed. But then instead of using the expensive treatment, the old drugs in low doses are being used. Initially doing something good for the poor patients. At the end, the result was surprisingly much better than expected. So in spite of using one-third, one-tenth of the dose, frequently very little side effects. And then you must find that there's a lot of hematological control, and shown by the epithelial stem cells, circulating stem cells being controlled. And immunologically, the adjustment seems to be also positive for cancer control. Those are the areas that I believe to be the real driving force behind metronomic treatments. Low dose, old drugs, why do they work? Now, they somehow fall into exactly the mechanism of pathway in herbal, in old, obsolete herbal treatment. Whether it's Ayurvedic medicine, Islamic medicine, herbal medicine, or Chinese medicine. All those areas work slowly. You need continuous and frequent administration. But then it could be proven to be anti-angiogenic, immunological supportive, and preventive. Very small, very little side effect. So this might be something that one should work closer together with metronomic therapy, because the achievement of metronomic therapy lies exactly as old herbal treatment, namely anti-angiogenesis, apoptosis promotion, immunological support, and because of all these, could be longer survival, could be even less metastasis. So the purposes of metronomic therapy initially after 5 to 7 years today has been found out to be toxic effects are limited because they are slow dose, small dose, drug resistance, of course, they are strict. They are given in low doses, so resistance is uncommon. And then you have all these antigenic and immuno defense achievements. We have done some work in the laboratory. Somita is an agent well known to control secondary after breast cancer surgery and also completing all the treatment. When Somita is added to Coriolis, that is the mushroom that's been used, you can see the result of the tumor transplant using the Somita together with Coriolis. The tumor weight, tumor size is much better. Metastasis likewise, metronomicals of Somita plus Coriolis give better result. And the histochemical changes likewise have been seen after likewise. So a small dose together with the supportive fungal herb seems to get a better result, at least in the animal. And then of course the VGF, which has been considered to be a good indication of angiogenic activity, the VGF has been also proven to be better controlled in the live animal using the genomic dose of the anti-cancer treatment. So the roundup, the management for cancer, of course, all those standards should be and have been proven to be effective. Maybe starting with the 20 to 30% of extremely late cases, 20 to 30% of those refractory cases, one could add on metronomic cancer treatment, chemotherapy, cheap, and yet could be more effective and supplementary to the major treatment. I think as far as we are concerned, we would actively participate in this new metronomic global health initiative in Hong Kong, and of course, if some of you belong to the Indian group of ambassadors, I'm most happy that you can, if you can connect us with the Indian oncologists who believe and who has started and who is researching on metronomic therapy. Because I do believe that the traditional herbal methods could be supplementary to this new initiative. With that, I thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you for this nice talk. The herbal treatment, I think it would be help to the patients who are affected by cancer. Then the modern techniques of treatments. Any question from the audience? Please, one question. Okay, sir, thank you.
Thank you so much for the beautiful speech narrated and given by Dr. Lingan. Can I have a round of applause for this gentleman? Yeah. So the next speaker is Dr. Shriram Shidali, who is going to speak upon alteration of a gut microflora by anti-cancer drug. Can I have a round of applause for this gentleman?